changes these days. Everybody's gone and run off.
What's up, everybody? My name is Kinetic, and welcome to my first Dark Souls 2 video, I guess. This is sort of a critique, a little bit of a review of my experience from the most recent rescheduled North America beta test for Dark Souls 2. I've got a few things listed here. I don't really have like a whole script of things that I'm going to say. It's really going to be right off the tip of my tongue, but I do have a list of things that I want to talk about from my experience from the beta test. And what you're actually looking at here, as you can see from the bottom right corner, this is not my beta footage. I have my own beta footage, actually. I recorded with commentary and face cam the entire beta experience, but I'm saving that for when FromSoft drops the NDA. This I wanted to use, I guess, since I can't really use my own. I'll use Game Trailer's footage instead, since there seems to be pre-approved beta footage for whatever reason. And then, when the time comes when FromSoft is ready, then they'll drop the NDA, and then I'll show you all of the footage that I have acquired. But these are visuals, all montaged, different clips from Game Trailers. If you want to see those clips, then definitely check out their site. They've got all of their own commentary and things like that to what they experienced in Dark Souls 2. But you guys want to hear what I think, right? Otherwise, you wouldn't be watching this video. So the first thing that I want to talk about is movement. One of the things that I heard quite a few people talking about and their first impressions of Dark Souls 2 beta was the new way that characters feel and move in combat when they're moving around enemies and things like that. Some people said, I think, that they felt like Dark Souls 2 felt more like Demon Souls than Dark Souls, this new game. And I guess that kind of, yeah, I can understand what they mean by that. I have played Demon's Souls myself. I noticed a little bit of a difference between Dark Souls 1 and 2. I'm not sure if it's really Demon's Souls-ish, but basically, the freedom of movement that you have, no matter what class you're playing, feels very responsive and a little bit looser, a little bit more reactive to what you want your character to do, and being able to position yourself around enemies the way you want to, being able to get out of dangerous positions if you're getting swarmed or things like that. Generally speaking, I feel like movement in Dark Souls 2 is a step up, definitely, from Dark Souls 1. It feels very similar, it feels familiar, it doesn't feel dramatically different or anything like that, but it just feels more fluid in the way your character does pretty much all of the actions. It's almost as if they sort of minimized the amount of frames that they put into different actions like rolling and all of these different things. It feels much more fluid, and I'm happy to say that it just generally feels much better. So that's a plus. Healing has changed, it seems, in Dark Souls 2. One of the things that I went into sort of with this beta test was I was completely unprepared. I had absolutely no knowledge of anything about Dark Souls 2 for the most part. I didn't know anything about the new life gems, which I'm about to talk about now. We no longer have just Estus flasks to take care of ourselves with. We have these life gems, and then we have different versions of life gems that give us healing over time. It's an item, basically, that you will pick up. I'm not sure if it comes from certain enemy types or if it's just a random drop in general. But what you do is you use the life gem just like you would use an Estus flask, and you consume the item, and then gradually, over time, it will heal you very slowly. Very slowly, a good amount, but slowly over time. It's not like an oh shit kind of item that you would use to quickly heal yourself before you possibly take a death blow, because it will not save you. It's the kind of thing that you would use maybe in between fights, or perhaps if you're in trouble and maybe you're out of Estus or something like that, you would turn to these life gems or radiant life gems or whatever the tier gem is, and you would like then give yourself some time to allow that life gem to heal you. Speaking of Estus flasks, I had one situation. I'm not sure if it is as I think it was. I mean, again, I really know nothing other than what I have personally experienced. But I remember I was under attack by an enemy, and I gave myself a little bit of space, and then I tried to consume an Estus flask. And normally in Dark Souls 1, what would happen, right, is you would be healed for that full amount that the Estus would give you, minus the enemy's damage if they're hitting you at the same time that you are trying to use an Estus flask. But what it seemed to happen to me in Dark Souls 2 beta was I was trying to drink my Estus flask, but then the enemy hit me, and not only did I take that damage, but I only healed up to the point, it seemed like, just before that enemy hit me. In other words, you will not be fully healed, but instead you will be interrupted, it seems like. But I'm not entirely sure if this is true or not. That's just what it looked like to me in that one situation. If you're drinking an Estus flask, as you are consuming it, and the Estus flask as well does not heal, it seems, as fast as it used to in Dark Souls 1. It takes a little bit more time. If an enemy hits you, or if you take damage during that time, it feels like the healing is interrupted and you will not be healed for that full amount. So that's something that I'm going to have to try to maybe test again, or maybe I would really like to hear other people's experiences and what they felt, if they have any similar situations with Estus, whether that's true or not. But yeah, that's kind of interesting. Estus had that situation, it seemed like, and these new life gems are a nice way to save your Estus for using Estus when you really need quicker healing, and use those life gems to give you a little bit slower healing over time in between fights. Backstabs. Here's one of the big things that I wanted to talk about. Of course, backstabs are a very important part and a really good part of the strategy to make your way through Dark Souls 1. You know, make your position behind the enemy, get in the right spot, and get in a backstab, because it's huge amounts of damage and just generally makes things faster. It felt even more so in Dark Souls 2 beta. It feels like when I'm just trying to go face to face against enemies, particularly the bigger ones, it can really take a much longer amount of time to whittle them down in a face-to-face confrontation compared to getting a backstab attack. Getting a backstab attack not only does tremendous amounts of damage, as it normally does, but here's the really interesting thing, and there's a slight difference between PvE monsters and PvP. After I backstabbed an enemy in PvE, right? So if I'm just backstabbing a zombie or some big monster or something like that, it would do great amounts of damage. And then, if you remember from Dark Souls 1, you had to wait until the enemy pretty much fully stood up before you could damage them again. There were those invincibility frames, so to speak, you know, from the time that you execute the backstab and till the time that they pretty much fully stand up straight, could you attack them again. But it's not like that in Dark Souls 2. What you can do is backstab a person, and as they start lifting themselves up a little bit, you can actually go ahead and start wailing away at them with your weapon. I mean, possibly dealing anywhere from the backstab damage plus that same amount and even more. You can double your damage, in other words. It feels like from the damage that you do with a backstab to all the damage that you can do while they're trying to get up. And it feels a little bit overpowered. I'm gonna go ahead and say that. It feels a bit overpowered to be able to deal that much damage while the enemy is trying to get up. Seems kind of a bit excessive. I think it encourages even more for you to go for backstabs, because you can pretty much kill anything then, no problem, as long as you get at least one backstab compared to a straight face-to-face confrontation. The encounters in PvP were a bit different though. Thankfully, you're allowed, once you've been backstabbed, for the most part, it felt like when I was backed up by an invader, I was able to roll away pretty quickly before they could start attacking me. So if that scared you about like getting your ass whooped after a backstab, it feels like you're pretty cool for the most part. Like you should be able to roll out of the way if you're quick enough about it. But for PvE, it's crazy the amount of damage you can do for a backstab. Parry and riposte is also a big thing as well. You've probably heard this before that when you're trying to parry now with a shield, different factors are in play that mean how fast you're able to parry. I don't think it's so much the type of shield you're using, but the stats that you have for movement and things like that. And I can't remember exactly right off the top of my head right now which of those stats affects your parry speed, but there is, I think, a stat from what I heard that you could increase that allows you quicker parries with your shield and stuff like that. It does take, there's a little bit more animation, just a little bit more animation now from when you're trying to get your shield ready into the parry position and then actually executing a parry with your shield. I know I've heard this before. Some people have said, yes, it takes a longer amount of time, more effort for your character to perform a parry. It's not that much, but it is definitely significant. You will have to rely a little bit more on your understanding of the enemy and knowing a little bit more how to get yourself into position earlier to allow that parry to happen. After that, then you could either just go ahead and start slashing away at your enemy while they're kind of sitting back in this reclined position, or you can perform sort of what is like a backstab, but instead from the front. One little thing that I noticed about that, when I was using a sword to attack an enemy while they were downed after a parry, it was no problem. But when I was trying to hit them with a spear, I kept missing for some reason. And this, it makes even less sense to me. But that happened quite a few times. I would parry, and then I would try to attack them with my spear, and it just kept on missing and missing. And then I was like, screw it, I'm just going to use my sword then for the attack after a parry, and that's what I ended up doing. I'm sure they'll probably tweak that so that way it's a bit more accurate. One of the really big problems that I had with one of the most disappointing things I felt like in the Dark Souls 2 beta was connections with other players. I had heard great things about people that were playing PvP and not having any issues with lag or, you know, sudden backstabs or something like that. But unfortunately, Dark Souls 2 beta felt pretty much exactly like it Dark Souls 1 feels like. And there's lag, there's people suddenly backstabbing me, there's people attacking me, and I'm on the other side of an area or something like that. It's really not as good as I've heard it is, unfortunately. I was really hoping that was going to be an issue of the past, that for example I here in Japan could go ahead and PvP with people in North America or whatever, no problem, like I can with many other games. But unfortunately, those situations did happen. I was invaded a few times, and for whatever reason the connection between me and this other player was just terrible. I could see them beginning to kind of circle around me for a backstab, but then they already were backstabbing me suddenly, not giving me any chance to realize that much that they were actually going for that. And then there was another situation where I had rolled and moved clear away like 20 feet from this one invader, and then he just started swinging his sword, and then suddenly I was dead, and I was like, what the hell? So that was a big bummer. The co-op with other players, for teaming up with players to take on monsters and bosses and stuff like that, was quite different. In most situations, when I was connected with other people and we were exploring and stuff like that, it was actually really smooth. It didn't seem like there were any issues there, which makes the whole problems with invaders even more mysterious to me Why couldn't it be as smooth for invaders as it was for just, you know, co-op with these other players? There was another kind of weird situation with that though as well, in that I put my summon sign down and I was summoned no problem each and every time by players. It seemed like I was able to go into their instance of the game and travel with them and complete objectives absolutely no problem. However, when I tried to summon other people from their summon signs, it failed every single time, and I was really disappointed by that I couldn't summon anybody. I mean, I was relieved in a way that at least people could summon me, but it doesn't really make any sense that I can be summoned, but I couldn't summon anybody. I was trying to summon good people, I was trying to summon invaders, I was trying to summon anybody and anything, but it failed each and every time. So that's a bummer. Yeah, I hope that with these network tests that they're performing, that they do understand that that's happening, and that they will do something about it, particularly about the PvP situation, because I want to PvP a lot in Dark Souls 2, but I will not do it if it's going to be like that. If I'm getting backstabbed out of nowhere, if I'm getting attacked from, you know, 20 feet away and dying and, you know, stuff like that, it's just going to be awful for me. Let's get one of the last, I guess, kind of negatives about my experience out of the way. The visuals of Dark Souls 2. Now, for the most part, the game looks pretty good, I think. But for some reason, I'm not sure what it is. It could be that I've been playing Dark Souls on PC. It could be what the game looks like to me while I'm recording with my Elgato HD capture card. I'm not sure what it is, but the visuals for Dark Souls 2 don't really seem to be as good as they should be, particularly textures. This is one of the big things that I have a problem with, is the way the textures look. I saw some textures that just looked absolutely awful. I saw some rock textures that looked terrible. I saw some sword textures. The sword texture of the warrior, the big great sword, doesn't look very good. In fact, the warrior's armor doesn't really look that good either to me. It has a specular highlight making it look shiny, but it looks like plastic. Not because of the shininess, but just because of the texture itself doesn't really convince me that his helmet is made out of metal, and other textures just looked really blurry and really crappy. And that was really disappointing, because I was expecting textures to actually be much, much better. There's a lot of pluses to the visuals, that the lighting is improved, generally speaking. I think in Dark Souls 2, I've heard some people complain about how dark the game is. I think that's just because of the area that we currently have access to. I don't think that we've had the chance to see a lot more of Dark Souls 2 to really judge whether the game is too dark or whatever, but I would say that textures definitely need improving, and just the clarity of the game seems to be lacking. There's a lack of sharpness, it seems like, in what I'm looking at, particularly with the character models and the enemy mobs as well, I would say. I hope that they up the textures and the detail for those. As far as the difficulty goes, I think that the difficulty definitely matches what I expect from Dark Souls. I heard some people say that they think that the game is even harder than Dark Souls 1. I don't believe that. After this test, it feels about, I would say, the area that we were given access to, which I think is the same area that everybody's had access to so far in testing, feels about on par with what you would feel from, say, I don't know, maybe like Sin's Fortress enemy difficulty, maybe kind of like Blight Town, but not really, something along that lines. Maybe that puts a bad taste in some people's mouths when I say Blight Town like that, but it's not, I don't feel like it's any more difficult than what I've experienced from Dark Souls 1. But there was something interesting towards the end of the test, and like the last, I think, the last 30 minutes or something like that, maybe the last 20 minutes of the test or something like that, they engaged some kind of hardcore difficulty or something like that message that came up on the screen. And it had like this kind of message. I was just glancing over it or something like that. That I guess they're testing to see how much harder they can make enemies' health pulls, maybe, or how much harder the enemies hit or something like that. I didn't really notice a difference. I'm not sure what exactly that was about, but they are toying with the difficulty settings, it seems, for Dark Souls 2. They haven't quite locked that down, I don't think. I did have a chance to try out one of the boss fights. It was a co-op that I did with a temple knight. I was playing as a soldier. I was playing as a soldier and I was co-oping with one other guy. He was playing as a temple knight, I believe. And we took on the three necromancer boss. It's basically like these three necromancer kind of characters, I think. And what they're doing is they're summoning a bunch of skeletons to fight for them. Kind of like a little bit like Nito from Dark Souls 1 a little bit. And it was pretty interesting. I mean, there wasn't any real mystery about it. It was just go ahead and kill everything. We did have some moments where we were being a little bit overwhelmed by the amount of skeletons and things that were attacking us, but you can simply run to the other side of the room. They're pretty slow, and you can get yourself healed up and re-engage against the enemies. In that situation, definitely trying to attack with a spear didn't work out too well for me. I was forced to switch to a sword, but it was a pretty fun boss fight. It seemed, of course, easy because of the fact that I was doing a co-op with one other person. In a single player kind of experience with nobody helping or something like that, I think it would be a pretty good challenge to try and fight all of the necromancers, and they cast magic at you, and also try to avoid getting raffle stomped by all of the skeletons that are popping up, including the spinning wheel skeletons like from Dark Souls 1. Those have returned in Dark Souls 2, and they are just as vicious as before. That was a pretty fun boss fight. One of the cool things, and one of my biggest pleasantries, I guess, from the Dark Souls 2 beta was the new UI. I had heard people complaining, actually, about the new UI, but I can't understand why, because it's just as nice looking and familiar as it was before. It's not a completely different UI or anything like that. It's pretty much what you expect from and what you're familiar with from the previous Dark Souls game, just a little bit cleaner and more organized and more responsive, it felt like to me. Instead of going to your weapons and scrolling through this huge list of shields, swords, spears, and all of these different things, uncategorized into just a single list, they have broken it down into swords, shields, spears in these different tabs that you can go to, which makes it much faster to be able to find the items that you're looking for. Not just weapons, but all items, keys, healing items and things like that. All of it has been categorized, and it's much more neater, much more organized. And generally speaking, I think that it's familiar to Dark Souls players, but it's definitely an upgraded version. And one of my favorite things that I'm not sure if you'll notice in this video, but you know how you'll be playing the game and you'll have the D-pad to access things from your left hand, things in your right hand, switching, you know, those things and the spells and your items and stuff like that by pressing on the D-pad. One of the really cool things that they added was like a little bit of a preview to what the next item will be. For example, if you're using a life gem, if you have, I should say, a life gem in that slot, what you'll see is you'll see like a little bit of a preview of what the next item will be when you press down. So if it's an Estus flask, after the life gem, you'll see like a little tiny Estus flask icon that lets you know, and kind of as a reminder, in case you don't have it all memorized, what the next item will be. And there's also a greater number of items that you can have equipped as well. I think it was 10. I think you can actually put now 10 items in that quick slot and press down to quickly change in between all of these different items, from the Estus to the life gems, the human effigies, which restore your humanity. And it's really nice. It's really convenient. And I think that's really, really good. I'm glad that they did that. And finally, I would like to just kind of quickly kind of glance over and talk about all of the different classes and my experiences with them. The first thing that I played was a soldier, because I love spears. I'm a spear kind of guy. I really enjoy using lances and spears in different RPGs. They're tons of fun to me. And so I spent probably almost the first 2 of the 3 hour beta test playing as the soldier, exploring and getting just the general feel of the game and also of the soldier. And it felt to me like, yeah, the soldier is perfect for me. It's mobile, but it's strong in pretty good in its defense and pretty good in its attack and stuff like that. But then I started to try out the other classes in the last hour. I gave those classes about 10 or 15 minutes of my time to get a sense of what they were like. I tried the dual swordsman, I think, next, and I was pleasantly surprised how good the dual swordsman felt. It wasn't, I don't know, I kind of went in there feeling like, is this just kind of like a gimmicky class that they're adding but really won't be viable? It felt really viable, actually. The speed at which that you can move as a dual swordsman compared to a soldier is much greater. You feel very light on your feet and swift, and you can quickly move into different positions that you need to with the dual swordsman. And with the type of equipment that you had right out of the box, you could either use 2 swords, one in each hand, or you could switch to an alternative sword and shield that was available as well. There was a small shield that you could use, so you could sword and board if you want to, or you could use the 2 swords, one in each hand. What I ended up doing was I just wanted to see how viable it was and how good it felt just using a sword in each hand. Now, obviously, you can't block like that. I mean, I thought maybe they might add something like that, where maybe you put your 2 swords up or something like that, and you have like a little bit of a blocking capability. I didn't notice if there was one. There may be, but I didn't figure out how to block as a dual swordsman, so I'm just assuming that there isn't. So what I ended up doing was I would use hit-and-run tactics with the more dangerous opponents for things like the regular zombies, no problem whatsoever. You just roll in there and you cut them to pieces. But there are these bigger targets which are much more dangerous, and they do not flinch to pain. You will not interrupt them. If they want to attack you, it doesn't matter what you're doing, they are going to hit you. So I had to kind of move in, get in maybe 1 or 2 hits, and then use whatever endurance I had left to try and get out of the way before they would hit me with whatever massive attack that they had. And it felt good. I was like, again, I was very surprised, pleasantly surprised, that the dual swordsman definitely does feel viable. You will have to, I think, have a really good endurance pool to allow yourself to get in and do some good combinations of attacks using the L1 R1 as the light attacks and the L2 R2 for each of those hands, right, for heavy attacks. And don't drain yourself completely of endurance. Allow yourself a little bit of endurance left to be able to make moves and to get out of either, you know, the enemy's attack because they're not flinching, or maybe some other enemies might come and try to jump you. Definitely try to save some endurance, I think, for those situations. I also tried, I think the next one that I tried after that was the sorcerer. I tried the sorcery class, and the sorcery caster felt pretty good, very squishy, which it should be, but it also very powerful. So a quite glass cannon-y feeling. Had a soul arrow, had a soul arrow shower or something like that, or soul shower, something like that, where basically you would cast kind of up and then an like a rain of soul arrows would come down kind of on top of your enemies in a small radius. There was also a magic sword or magic greatsword, something like that. You would summon it in a really big kind of winding up to and then executing a big sweeping attack. That would be great for groups. There was also a heal, I think, and it felt as it should. The sorcerer felt right where it should be. Didn't feel too powerful, actually. Didn't feel too weak. I think that they will need that power because they are definitely vulnerable to getting hit. One of the cool things that they did also for the opening equipment set is they gave you access to not just a staff to cast your spells with, but you also had a shield and a dagger. And what I thought would be probably efficient would be to cast a couple of times to bring down the enemy's health, but then to save if what the amount of damage that I would do with the sorcery would be sort of overkill, I would save that cast instead and just switch over to my dagger, maybe two-handed, and then go ahead and finish off my target. And I think that might be a pretty good strategy, if not just using dagger most of the time and save your spells for when it really counts. But there is also an item now that will replenish a little bit of your casts, which is pretty damn sweet. You won't have to go to a bonfire now to replenish all of your casts. There's an item that you consume, that you can consume, and it will give you, I'm not sure how many because I didn't actually try it, but it will give you a few casts back, I guess, with whatever your sorcery is. So that's pretty cool. I also tried out the other classes, including, what was next? I think it was the Temple Knight, I think I tried next. And this was really surprising to me. I think that the Temple Knight is a really, really powerful class and really good defensively, very good offensively, and comes equipped with miracles, including a heal and some other kind of buff to do something. I can't remember what that buff did, but they felt really, really strong. Felt like a little bit heavier in movement, but not greatly compared to the soldier, but just felt really, really powerful. I thought that soldier would be really good for me if I wanted a kind of sword and board, or in this case it was actually an axe and a halberd, I think, that the Temple Knight had to use. And these were very powerful weapons with really powerful attacks that would be kind of slam down chops or really big spinning attacks for massive amounts of AoE damage against a bunch of people trying to come after you. Really, really good stuff with the Temple Knight. I also tried next, I think I tried the Huntsman after that, and this was the most disappointing one. I was expecting that for this class, I would be obviously medium to light kind of armor, so a bit squishy, but also good with damage. So kind of a little bit more mid-range in between defense and offense in terms of power from a glass cannon or a tank, but I felt an extreme lack of power using the bow particularly. And I felt also very squishy, just as squishy as the sorcerer, but completely lacking in the ranged damage that I should be able to perform with a bow. I mean, as I was plucking away with my bow, it was costing me massive amounts of endurance, like about a third or more, I think, of the amount of endurance that I had right out of the box playing the class. And also, the attacks were really, really weak. In fact, they were so weak, I felt like it was completely pointless using the bow, and instead I should just switch over to my light shield and sword and just attack that way. The bow felt completely useless to me. I noticed something kind of interesting about it. At long range, I would do very weak damage, but at closer range, like almost point blank with a bow, I would do like twice as much damage. But even still, it was so much weaker compared to the damage that I could do with a sword. It was like half or less the amount of damage that I was doing with a bow compared to a sword. So I felt like it was completely useless to me, which doesn't make any sense to me for this class. It seemed to me, my assumptions, be them correct or wrong, were that that it would be a more viable piece of equipment to use for killing enemies. You know, I mean, it shouldn't be extremely powerful, of course, because it is a ranged weapon after all. But if I'm going to be just as squishy as it felt like as a sorcerer, then my ranged attacks should be just as powerful, I think, as the sorcerer's then. Otherwise, what's the advantage of playing, you know, like that? What's the advantage? I don't really see it, unless the advantage is sort of the hybrid with maybe pulling enemies, I guess, with a bow, and then actually using your sword after that or something like that to attack. I don't know. I really felt like I was struggling with that class, and it was pretty disappointing, because I thought that it would be much better than that. I think that there's going to be some tweaking done, or that definitely needs to be done, or perhaps, I don't know, maybe I just was doing something wrong. I'm not sure what it is, but it was expensive in endurance, and it was really low in damage in the end, I felt like. And if I'm not forgetting any other classes, the last class that I played was the warrior, and this is the one that we've seen kind of walking around in the cool cinematic trailers with the helmet, and also the one I was complaining about with his textures on his armor. But I'm not going to talk about that anymore. I'm just going to talk about how the warrior felt. The warrior feels somewhere in between the soldier and the templed knight. You have this big ass two-hand sword, which has awesome skills for big sweeping and heavy attacks on enemies, can just literally slap around zombies like ping pong balls around the areas. It's hilarious how you can knock them up into the air and like off of cliffs and stuff like that. Really, really awesome. And then you also have a really nice shield and a sword in your hand that you can use. And it was a really nice combination. It felt lighter than the Temple Knight and less defensive as well. Like, the amount of damage that I was taking, I was a little bit surprised, was more than I was expecting, because kind of at first glance, especially I think because of that helmet, you get this sense that it's like almost like a heavy armor class, but not so much. That's why I kind of see it or kind of say it's a little bit in between, like how strong defensively the Temple Knight felt, but not as much, a little bit closer, I guess, to the soldier in terms of how much damage they could take compared to the more heavier and more defensive, it felt like, Temple Knight. But they can definitely deal out tons of damage with their weapons, particularly the two-hand. It is quite slow, so you have to be aware of the wind-up time that it takes for him to start spinning that big-ass sword. But it's awesome. It felt really, really good. And I'm going to have a hard time, I think, deciding exactly which, if these classes remain as they are, with which ones we have available to us and how they are when the game launches. I think I'm going to have a tough time deciding, if I don't play any more beta, which class I would start with. Because I like heavy armor classes. They just look awesome for the most part. And I like awesome heavy weapons. And yeah, those three, the soldier, the temple knight, and the warrior, felt about as they should. I would almost say it's the temple knight and the warrior feel very, very similar, just a little bit different in their playstyle and what equipment they have available and kind of their initial direction coming out of the box. The warrior obviously is mostly just going to be about defense. And then, or excuse me, not defense, but strength. And then either you're going to go more strength and more offense, or maybe you will kind of balance it or go more defensively. And the Temple Knight comes with its own miracles, right? Of course. So you would kind of do a hybrid sort of paladin or Templar kind of thing with the Temple Knight. And the soldier feels more like kind of a medium armor, but good and swift damage with the spear. I'm not sure if I remember mentioning which exact equipment the soldier had. He had a spear and shield and sword available to him as a soldier, and it was it was really, really good playing all of the different classes. Overall, it feels like, for the most part, the balance is there. They feel about as they should, except for that bow class. That was by far the most disappointing thing. But on the bright side, the dual swordsman definitely is going to be fun if you are feeling like you don't want to block and you are confident in your ability to maneuver around enemies and things like that. Then the dual swordsman is going to be tons of fun, I think, for you. And I think I have rambled on long enough for this video. I'm probably going to have to double the double the footage that I've actually intended to use for this video. But I wanted to make sure that I got those impressions to you guys for how it felt to play Dark Souls 2 beta. Again, I have my own footage that I would definitely like to use, and you will see exactly what I went through as a completely new player into Dark Souls 2, not knowing anything, just going in blind. And I think that that's going to be fun to watch. So once they drop the NDA, then I will definitely be happy to put that up for you guys. In the meantime, I hope that you've enjoyed this video. If you have any questions about any other things from the Dark Souls 2 beta, let me know in the comments section below. And I'd really appreciate it if you click the like button to show your support for Dark Souls 2 and that content here on my YouTube channel. If you happen to have any friends or whatever that are interested to hear some more Dark Souls 2 beta impressions, definitely share this video with your social networks of Twitter, Facebook, Google Plus, or whatever. I have connections there as well. Look for links to that in the description of this video. And of course, don't forget to subscribe for more Dark Souls content coming up soon. My name is Kinetic, and I'll see you guys next time.